hold on tight. The champ is here. Mikey is raising the roof. He is loving it.
Let's be real for a second.
Let's be real. I'm excited to be real today. Mikey, we're now explain yourself.
I don't hate Russell Wilson.
Todd hates T.Y. Hilton. I know why he likes Nick Foles. Do you know why? Because he scored 55 points against him in the championship game last year.
Running backs and Andy Reid systems, just fantasy gold mine. Sign me up there, man.
Yeah, and he's passing for 1,000 too, because his offensive weapons are
Maybe. Oh, my God. I can't even believe this, Eric. Todd comes out with some outlandish shit.
Oh, come on.
But that one wins the night.
You deserve the torture of watching those games if you get him.
There's a problem with what all those names. None of those guys are good.
Exactly. That's my point. That is 100% my point.
Hey. All I'm saying. Hey. I'm a very unique individual. You know, that's
I'm sure all the owners think so.
Oh, here man. We go. Just when I think they're out, they pull me back in.
Well, the playoffs have arrived, and we have our six teams set and ready to go for the MHA playoffs. And a wild week in a fantasy football. You got to love it and hate it at the same time. I'm Eric Lansing, along with Mikey Renault and Todd Diamond. Guys, the regular season is over. How fast does it go?
That's been, for as many times the NFL has had to, like, we had games on Tuesday night. It seemed like the season just kept on going. Yeah, kept on, you know, going, weeks on end. So, yeah, been nice.
Mikey, what you thinking?
Couldn't end soon enough.
Yep. Mikey's Super Bowl didn't go as planned. We could call him the Falcons of the podcast. How about that? From when he played the Patriots in the Super Bowl, it looked like you were right there and then came all the way back in the fourth quarter. We'll talk about that a little bit. We'll go into the MHA standings. There's a lot to talk about, and we'll get to some top performances, tell you how the playoffs are going to lay out, and we'll talk about the dough of the week as well. So let's get into it. The MHA standings, the top team in our league, finished out with a win. The Cooper's Cousins squad, 11-2 overall this season. They defeated Gonzo Cats 136-118. His Minnesota trio of Adam Thielen, Kirk Cousins, and Dalvin Cook combined for 92 points. Cooper Cousins is the number one seed, earning a first-round bye. Gonzo Cats' loss drops him into the sixth seed, but still in the playoffs. Also earning a first-round bye is Eaton W's. They are the number two team after taking the 145-120 win over Kilgore Trout. After starting the season 2-4, Kevin's squad won 7 straight to end the regular season. 19 points from a weekly pickup, this week pickup of Mike Gesicki, to go along with 5 other players in double figures. Kilgore Trout, his loss drops him to 11th place, and he'll pick second in 2021. Earning the 3 seed is NWA, who took full advantage of Lion Rip having a tough week. Just 30 points from Justin Herbert for NWA, but he had 7 players in double figures, which include 3 with 20 points each from Jonathan Taylor, Travis Kelce, and James Robinson. With the loss, Lion Rip drops to the 4th seed. Notorious CUP, who needed a win and a Lemonheads loss to get into the playoffs, fell to bye week in a blowout fashion, 161-109. Corey Davis, 26 points, and 21 points from Justin Jefferson. Quayne's team finishes in 8th place and will draft 5th in 2021. And bye week finishes right behind him in 9th and will select 4th. The Lemonheads put up the highest point total of the week, dropping 163 points to the squad that had given up the most points all season in the Hot Tamales. That will put Eric's team at 7-6. And instead of being 6th in the playoffs, as we assumed, he'll actually jump into the 5 seed. The Lemonheads, what a crazy, crazy game, I guess, the Monday and tonight's game. Mikey, all season long, I don't have the exact number tallied up, but I just know by looking at coming into this week, you gave up the most points and you lost the team that gave up or scored the most points this week. So that's you were talking about that before, and of course that's the way the cookie crumbles. That's the way it finishes.
Yeah, par for the course.
It happened on pretty close to the end of the game play, where at this point the Cowboys are pretty much done. Mikey's first round pick, Ezekiel Elliott, who he eventually would trade away, had three chances to score from the 1 yard line. And on fourth down, they throw it in the back of the end zone to Amari Cooper. And that put me over the top and put me into the fifth spot. So, yeah, this is how it goes sometimes for fantasy. I would like to say I feel bad for you, Miguel, and I kind of do, because I feel like I haven't had the best luck this year either, but just the way it goes. Huh? At least it didn't cost you a playoff spot.
you haven't had over 1,800 points against, kind of luck.
1,800 points. Woo! That's by far the most. And, yeah, that's a big number. I'll keep going here, and we'll talk more about it as we go along if Mikey wants to. The Butterfingers put up 150 points to smash the Belt Sanders by 45. Nice free agent pickup by Butterfingers as they picked up Ryan Tannehill, who had 62 points. Also had a big run. I wouldn't say a big day, but he had a big run from his boy Aaron Jones, who ended up with 22 points. Todd will finish 7th overall and will pick 6th next year. Allen will pick number 1 for the second straight year. And that leads us into some MHA trivia.
All right, Brain. You don't like me and I don't like you. But let's just do this and I can get back to killing you with beer. It's a deal.
And this is actually MHA trivia because it's going to be about drafting in back-to-back years. I know we talked about this, so I don't know if you guys did your homework, but I just did it before we got on the air. So with the Belt Sanders picking first for 2 straight years, is he the first MHA team to ever do that? And if not, who was the other team or teams? Guesses? Was it Mikey?
No, it was not me.
Am I going to mention Robbie?
Is that going to be your pick?
Yeah, I'll go with him.
Mikey, has it ever happened before? And if not, or I guess, yeah. So if wait a minute. Is he the first team to ever do that? And if not, who was the other team? Or teams?
I'm going to say he's the first team to do it because I just don't remember it happening.
And the winner is Mikey Renault. It has never happened in our league. We've never had someone draft first overall in back-to-back picks. But Todd, I'm going to give you a chance to redeem yourself, okay?
Yeah.
How am I going to do this? All right, let me ask you this. Todd, have you ever picked first?
No.
That is correct. You have never picked first overall in an MHA draft. Mikey, have you ever picked first?
I think I have. I seem to remember having a really bad year. Kurt Warner had gotten hurt back in the day. So I'm going to say I have.
That is correct. Back in 2005, you had the first overall pick.
But, Eric, does it count the fact that the first year I was in the league, I did pick first, but that was because of a trade?
That does not count.
Okay. I'll take my win.
I didn't see that, and I didn't look into super depth. I just grabbed whoever picked first. But
okay.
Good job. I mean, that's good that you know that, because I didn't know that.
Yeah.
All right, so Mikey's up 2-1. Todd, how many times have I drafted first, if ever?
I'll go with 2 times.
I'm sorry, that's incorrect. Mikey?
It's tough. You've never, like, been that bad. But I do remember you having Peyton Manning a couple times, and back in the day, you would have had to have been up there in order to do it. I'm going to say once.
Good job, Mikey. It was once. Now, it was in 2004, and I did pick Peyton Manning. However, that was the year that we drew out of a hat because we brought on a bunch of my college colleagues into the league. The year before, I actually finished 2nd. So that year, we actually drew it out of a hat and it wasn't based on where I finished. But Mikey gets the point anyway. And we'll do 2 more. So I'll give Todd a chance to try to tie things up. How many times is Aaron drafted first, if ever?
I don't think none. I don't think Aaron's ever drafted first.
I'm sorry, that's incorrect, and you should have known that since we were talking about that right before we started this podcast, because he was the fucking bastards. So, Mikey, how many times is Aaron drafted first? Was it just that one time? Or was
It was more than once because he was also fourth and cunt. So,
oh, yeah.
That is correct. Mikey just missed all the points today. That's funny. Is correct. So, yeah, he is picked first once. All right, last question. Anybody can just throw it out. Who is drafted first the most? And how many times?
I will go with Robbie on this one.
Okay.
Yeah. I'll go with Babish, maybe.
No, Babish is only drafted first overall once. Venti is in a tie for second. He drafted three times along with Ryan, Supreme Clientele, who has drafted three times first overall. And the winner is, of course, it's Alan, because he's got four. So Alan has drafted first four times, including next year. Okay. So there's your MHA standings. And here is the playoffs coming up this week. Cooper's Cousins and Eaton W's are in first round byes. And the first round matchups look like this. Three seeded NWA will battle six seeded Gonzo Cats. And the Roomies will go toe to toe. The 4-5 matchup between Lion Rip and Lemonheads will be the other matchup. So there you go. The playoffs ready to roll this week, ready to roll Thursday, which is like a couple days away. Anything you guys want to say about those playoffs, or should we go into the top performers? I know neither one of you are there, so maybe you want to keep going, but you feel free to ramble and chat.
Yeah, I mean, obviously between you and Aaron, it's stuff's going to go down, so we'll see.
Like, Aaron's already stressed.
Yeah,
I went upstairs and talked to him about it. She goes, "Oh my gosh, I'm stressed already." I'm just gonna work. I'm actually gonna work at work and just hide from here for the next week.
Yeah, I mean, you know, and then on the fact that, you know, that Dylan and Kevin both have first round byes, so you know, that's, you know, again, if Dylan wins the championship, he has to give you half of that money because you drafted his team. It is amazing. It's amazing that, like, you know, you drafted his team and he's made moves, but like other than that,
very little moves. He's made the least amount of moves. In fact, he's not even a double figures in terms of at least adds and drops and so forth. So
Jesus. Yeah, but he's made some trades that have helped him win weeks. So I gotta give him credit for that.
Yeah, absolutely. It's not like he's just ignored it and has done great. He's been a good manager and he's made trades. He's made some crazy trade offers, but he's made some trades. And so good for him. The last thing I'll say, unless you guys want to mention something else, is Cooper's Cousins has lost twice this year. And they've both been to NWA.
Hmm.
Go figure that. I don't know what that means, if they'll see each other again. But G was kind of, when we were talking about me possibly, because we thought it was going to be me and G going at it, just how bad my team was playing initially. And so we were kind of talking back and forth. And so if he gets to see Cooper's Cousins, I don't know, I'd have to look and see if it's bracket or if it's seeding. But those are the playoffs. Top performances. Mikey, you want to throw one at me?
Yeah, how about Josh Allen? Because that one really killed me.
Holy cow. Yeah, no kidding. That was impressive.
70 points.
Astronomical.
375 and four touchdowns. That's
against the 49ers, no less. Now, I'm not saying they're like the 49ers of old or maybe even last year, but I was surprised they were able to just kind of pick him apart. They played a lot of zone and it was just one completion after another. Both, really, all three of their wide receivers just cashed in. So it was one of those things you kind of, because I was in the playoffs, even if I didn't win this week, I was like, can we save that for next week? But, you know, at the same time, I move up a spot. But yeah, that was incredible. We were joking. You and I were joking. And I said, boy, he's going to have an astronomical performance for me even to get close. And he put it up on Monday night, so it was kind of fun to watch, at least for me. Todd, you have a top performer? Oh, go ahead, Mikey.
It'll get much tougher for him next week.
Yeah, they got the Steelers, so that's going to make me do a lot of thinking in this next week. Todd, give me a top performer from this past week 13.
I'll go with, again, in second straight week, with David Montgomery. 24 points, 17 rushes, 17 yards, two rushing touchdowns, four receptions for 39 yards. I mean, kind of maybe found – Chicago's maybe found a found their running back of the future. They've got to get a quarterback to help out, and I think they'd be okay. But David Montgomery, he's, you know, another back-to-back, you know, 23 last week and 24 this week. So, you know, that's two good back, that's two good, you know, weeks back-to-back. So that's, you know, something for, you know, for next year for running back that I think they got drafted in the later rounds. So David Montgomery.
Yeah, came in a losing effort for Gonzo Katz, but you can't ignore he was the number one running back in our league from this past weekend. He had 23 against Green Bay, 24 against Detroit, and has Houston next week. So, yeah. Nice matchup for Gonzo Katz in the first round of the playoffs. Gosh, there's just so many good performances from this past week. I mean, I was really surprised about Corey Davis to come in. I mean, he was on someone's bench, so he wasn't just picked up, but he hadn't really been played. And for bye week to put him in helped him out a ton. And, you know, we've kind of mentioned him a couple times this year. He's put up some decent numbers. He's put up some dud. He really only had one dud. He had a six in there. He had six last week, so you figure coming in. But with Cleveland going up by so much in that first half, it was just throw for Tennessee. And Davis ended up with a season-high 11 catches, 182 yards. Might be his best game as a professional. He also had a touchdown in there as well. Mikey, you want to give me another one?
Sure. I got to throw it out to Davante Adams. 28 points again this week, and he is on some sort of tear that I have not seen a receiver go on in quite some time over his past seven games. Like, it's just flat out ridiculous. You look at his past seven games, 34, 27, 24, 15, 18, 15, 28 last week. I mean, we haven't seen this type of stuff, like, not even last year out of Michael Thomas with anything like this.
Yeah.
I would say good luck with him next week, Eric, if he continues doing what he's doing.
Yeah, no kidding. And they force-feed him the ball. I mean, they really force-feed him the ball. And why not? He makes incredible catches. He's not one that just catches passes down deep and – you know, like maybe like a Tyreek Hill does, like in any space, or it doesn't matter what route. It could be behind the line of scrimmage. It could be 20, 30 yards downfield. He's a force to be reckoned with, and they force the ball to him. And he's been incredible. 84 receptions, over 1,000 yards, and 13 touchdowns, and still three games to go. So impressive, and definitely makes me nervous. I'm definitely crapping on myself in his wide receiving core.
Well, yeah, and he has a touchdown in every single one of those seven games.
Hmm.
So, you know, 11 total in the last seven. So it's just, I mean, I'd have to go back to like Megatron back when he had that year where, you know, he was breaking the receiving yards record to find some, you know, stuff that's been going on like this. I mean, it's incredible.
Yeah, he will be. At the end of the season, when we do some bold predictions for that, Davante Adams will be the first wide receiver taken next year, no matter what. I think he'll jump Michael Thomas. You can put that later for when we do bold predictions at the end of the season for next year. But Davante Adams will be the first wide receiver taken. I'll say that one right now.
I'm not sure that's really bold, though.
No, it isn't.
I mean, if it was up to me, Adams would be my first wide receiver, and it wouldn't be Michael Thomas's number two either.
Yeah, but I'm just saying it's just bull. I mean, again, because you don't know if he can do it again. Because, I mean, I said my bold prediction.
Freeze is going to be back.
Yeah.
Here's the reason it's not bold. I mean, Adams was like, what, second or third at the latest this year. Mm-hmm. So him from 2 to 3 to 1, that's not that big of a jump. But I'm just saying.
It's bold for Todd.
Yeah.
It's bold for Todd. Todd, do you have another top performance from this weekend?
Well, I'll just finish off the one again, because, again, I could have had him on my team, but Justin Jefferson, Jesus, mother of God, he's probably going to win Rookie of the Year, probably. I mean, he just they just like Devontae Adams, they're force feeding the ball to him. You know, again, it's probably my dough of the year, week, or whatever. If we're not tricking,
we'll determine that later. But you're a definite candidate.
but you know, and you know, again, and we talked about, you know, which rookie wide receiver was going to have the most, you know, who's going to the bigger impact out of them. And we thought maybe to some degree, I was being Broncos fan, we maybe thought, you know, Jerry Jeudy would be the one, but Justin Jefferson, hey, you know, 12 targets, 9 receptions, and 121 yards receiving and a touchdown. Yeah, he's won that one. He's the best rookie wide receiver, at least for this year. So good on that one. And again,
he's also kind of flying up the points total too in terms of overall season. I think he was 15th or 16th the last time we kind of mentioned him. He's up to 10th. He's in the top 10 in terms of scoring in our league, which is incredible. He's fun to watch.
He's broken. I mean, he's already broken some of Randy Moss's rookie records already. So yeah. You know, stupid me. Not thinking. So okay, moving on.
One I have to mention, and I'm not a big fan of going to my guys, but you can't ignore what Darren Waller did.
No.
5 points, 13 receptions, 200 yards, and 2 touchdowns.
Yeah.
I knew he was going to be better this year, and there was moments where he disappeared, but he caught David Carr in a good week. David Carr had a great week for Mikey, too. Big reason why I kind of threw Waller and Aguilar out there is like, well, if he's going to throw touchdowns, it's going to be to those guys. And obviously Henry Ruggs picked up the last one that made it real difficult, but Darren Waller, still second behind Kelsey. I'm wondering how close he was going to get after that big performance. He's still 30 points behind Travis Kelsey, but he is, 40 points ahead of TJ Hockenson. So for someone who's got 77 receptions and 7 touchdowns, pretty good value where I got him. He was incredible, especially in that first half.
Yeah. I mean, again, talking about, you know, finding the right tight ends and the fact that you didn't have to reach for Waller either. Like you said, you got him in what round did you get him in?
5th or 6th.
So holy crap, 5th or 6th. I mean, and for a tight end, I mean, Kelsey, I know is you know, light years and, you know, ahead of everybody, which again, that's what it is. But getting Waller where you got him, and you know, 35 points, that's Jesus, that's like running back or wide receiver. I mean, Waller again might, you know, again, I think he's still the, you know, Kelsey, Kittle, and then Waller. But I mean, with Kittle's, you know, kind of being injury prone a little bit, maybe next year Waller might, you know, I mean, not doing a bold prediction on that.
Now that would be a bold prediction.
Okay, I'm just saying that Waller would jump Kittle. I mean, I'm not saying Waller's going to jump Kelsey. I'm not going that far. I might be smoking something on that. But Waller might, because Kittle's just injury prone. I mean, an injury, and it's not most of the performance. Obviously, when Kittle's on the field, I mean, Mikey, you know that obviously having him, you know, he can ball out too. But it's the injury factor. Waller has been more durable. And, you know, like you said, you know, some games sometimes he disappears a little bit, but you're kind of okay with that because when he does play really well and put up big numbers, you're like, holy crap, I got good value. So Waller, I don't know, next year might leapfrog Kittle for number 2. So we'll see.
I think that would be a mistake, but that's personal opinion. 35 points will skew your overall score. Now, I'm not trying to – don't take this the wrong way, and I'm not trying to badmouth Waller because he is a really good player, but I'm saying what one performance does to his overall seasonal score.
He'd still be second. He just wouldn't have a big lead as second.
Right.
But I see what you're saying. I ended up getting Waller in the 6th round. Probably won't go in the 6th round next year. Let's talk about some stinkers.
Yeah, Mo, that team sure did suck last night. They just plain sucked. I've seen teams suck before, but they were the suckiest bunch of sucks that ever sucked.
Some guys that just pooped themselves this past week. Todd, we'll let you go first.
All right. Well, I'm going to go with one of my guys, freaking Kyle Rudolph, putting up a goose egg. probably could have found maybe two or three or other more tight ends better, and maybe could have put up more points. And there were, and that, he kind of just, you know, crapped a bet on that one because all the catches and targets were going to Justin Jefferson. So, like I said, you're right. Maybe I should, if I would have had him, I wouldn't have to worry about that. But yeah, I'll go with Kyle Rudolph.
in a winning effort, he got a goose egg. So, way to go. Mikey, what do you want to say something?
Well, I just have a problem with that being, you know, because when we go through these poor performances, Todd chooses a player that you kind of knew was going to have a poor performance anyways. Kyle Rudolph, he sucks. I mean, what did you expect? Seriously.
I was expecting more of a goose egg. Like, I expecting at least like 5 or 6 points. Jeez. I mean, I don't know what it matters.
Look,
but still.
I think what the show is looking for is people that you think are going to do well that didn't. So I'm going with Derrick Henry. A week after scoring 37, comes down with a measly 5 in a matchup that the Gonzo Cats, you know, was fighting for positional seeding in the playoffs. And yeah, he didn't really help him much this week.
No, he did not. That was a very, very good call. It's always tough to... Was he a first round pick? I assume he had to be, but for a guy that you desperately needed, and that was game script, right? Again, that goes back to the Browns put up 35, 38, whatever points in the first half, and they had to throw, and that pretty much eliminated him because he's not one to catch out of the backfield either. So that was pretty, probably the the worst performance of the week. I mean, one of the ones that jumped out to me, was just how it affected everybody. How about the Chargers offense? I know it ended up really hurting G, who ended up going with Justin Herbert. But you're talking about 1 point from Hunter Henry, and I know that's a guy that CUP was in need of to try to come back. I know it probably wouldn't have mattered even if he had a good game, but 1 point from Hunter Henry. Austin Eckler, he's used to putting up 13, 14, 15 points. He only had 8. And, man, they just shut out the Chargers, a team that's putting up big numbers. And now New England's got a good defense, but to do what they did had been tough to watch for those who had Chargers. Todd, you have another one? I'm scared to ask.
very good. Terry McLaurin, only 2 points after, you know, obviously the matchup. Last week was against Dallas, but, you know, only putting up 2 points. And when he's the main focus, I mean, give credit to Pittsburgh for shutting him down. But, yeah, Terry McLaurin, only 2 points for Notorious CUP.
Yeah. Mikey, what you got? Anything else?
I do. And I was waiting to go in on this guy.
Wow. Did you hear that sigh from Miguel?
Jesus.
Yeah. It's not his fault, but this is where I mentioned how it was perfect that Elliott didn't get in those 3 tries against you being my first round pick. But let me tell you what was even better than that. Okay. The guy that you traded me, Miles Sanders.
Okay? Yes.
3 points scored in a matchup against a team that has been god-awful against running backs all year, and he gets 10 carries. Now, this is not his fault. This just shows you how incompetent the Philadelphia Eagles and their coaching staff has been all season. If they just flat-out refuse to run the ball, and look where they're at now. Carson Wentz is benched. Miles Sanders is doing nothing. There you go.
Yeah, that's a good call. I mean – you know, they kind of tantalized you at the beginning. He had some good games at the beginning of the season. So 17, 13, 22, 12, had another 12. The last 3 weeks have not been good. The thing that I'm also kind of noticing, and I don't have that exact set, but it doesn't look like they throw him the ball much either, which was a big reason why we all, at least I liked him going into this year, because what, he had 50 catches last year? So I was like, yeah, I want this guy. That's why I drafted him initially. Well, he's a guy that's going to get a bulk of the carries. He's going to get passes from the quarterback because their wide receiver crew is not great and they've been injured. And it's just kind of not panned out that way, or at least as well as we probably hoped.
Well, how could you throw him the ball when you're always throwing it to the other team?
This is true. They've turned the ball over a lot, both interceptions and fumbles. And I'm just trying to look up his stats in terms of catches. And it looks like he's got 19 catches on the year. So, geez, 39 targets. And, oh, man, tough year for Miles Sanders for sure. So one guy that I was kind of looking at because was A.J. Brown, and, of course, at CUP again. And I don't want to shit on him by any stretch, but, I mean, it was just such an important game. But it was Corey Davis for bye week and A.J. Brown for CUP. And what CUP's or what A.J. Brown has done, especially last week when he had two touchdowns and 20 points, he only ended up with 6 points. And that's got to be tough because Ryan Tannehill just threw the ball at 62 points from a quarterback, and especially the Corey Davis show. So that was tough to see. Yeah. Anything else? Any other ones? I mean, you saw a couple guys go out with injuries pretty early. Frank Gore was one in the second play. Not that it mattered. Antonio Gibson went out in like the first drive for Kilgore Trout, and that made somewhat of a difference. There were some injuries that took some guys out of the games early, which is always tough to see. But next up, who we got for Doe of the Week?
This one's a hard one because not a lot of those games this week were close.
They were not.
Other than mine. So I guess, I mean, it'd be hard to give it to me because there wasn't much more I could have done.
Yeah, the only thing I saw from your side of things was you could have switched Ruggs for Le'Veon Bell, and it would have made a tie. But does that constitute a Doe of the Week? I don't know.
But let me ask you, in any situation, and if anybody's willing to say they wouldn't have done what I did, then they're 10 times smarter than I'll ever be. But Le'Veon Bell ended up starting and playing the whole game.
True. And the tough situation about it is you had to make that decision, at least at that flex, before the 11 o'clock game when the Raiders played.
Right.
So you had to make it then. So you could, and the thing that we find out later, not that it mattered, which screwed a lot of owners over, which includes Kilgore Trout, is they said that, because, I mean, all week long, Clyde Edwards-Helaire was questionable. And then leading up to the game, he's active. And then he ends up not even playing, and you benefit by putting Le'Veon Bell in there. So, I mean, it's tough to say, who would you go for? I mean, you could say that Ruggs could have been a good play. I mean, you had Derek Carr. So you figured they were going to throw the ball a ton. So, I mean.
Right, but the one thing I was saying, the one thing I paid attention to was, Edwards-Helaire was questionable, but he didn't practice Thursday or Friday. And usually that's like a telltale sign whether or not a dude's going to play.
Yeah.
So I had a good feeling about that. That's why I did it.
Any other candidates then? If it's not, Todd, we're going to put it in your hands.
Okay.
Break the top.
Okay.
So if, and you could tell us, I mean, it wouldn't have won either one of us the match, or wouldn't won Mikey the match if he would have put Ruggs in.
Mm-hmm.
It would have been a tie. And I don't know the winning percentage and how that would have worked in terms of if that would have pushed me down to 6 as opposed to 5. But is that the Doe of the Week?
Yeah, I mean, because there's just not any. I mean, again, I guess if I was to be the Doe of the Week because I didn't put enough because I need to score.
Oh, wait a minute, we're not going back to you.
I know, just kidding. But no, I you know what? No, I don't know if we could really put a Doe of the Week for this week because this week of this situation. I don't know. The Edwards-Helaire thing just, I think threw everybody for a loop. So, you know what? I'm going to plead the fifth and say, I don't think there should be a Doe of the Week this week. I think this is,
I let it up to you. So you're going to, no Does are handed out this week. Good job, owners. Way to make the right moves. It definitely would have been me if I would have lost because I definitely left Cole Beasley on my bench, and he could have played anywhere and done better. So, all right. Let's just talk about whatever we want here. in the last five or 10 minutes, if 10 minutes is pushing it. But playoffs, we're here. The regular season's over. Anything you guys want to talk about? Anything, you have any predictions, or you guys kind of like anything you want?
I mean, as long as whoever, somebody just has to make sure Aaron doesn't go back to back again. Because if Aaron goes back to back again, it's not going to hear the end of it till the end of time. But I don't know, the matchup. So Gonzo, Katz, and G, right? That's the 3-6 matchup.
That is correct.
Okay. You know, I mean, with Pollen's team, you know, it's Deshaun Watson. I mean, if Deshaun Watson can, you know, I mean, obviously his wide receiver core keeps getting diminished because that, you know, obviously Fuller suspended, Cobb's hurt. They let Kenny Stills go. You know, so there's. weapons-wise around Deshaun Watson, not the best, but I mean David Johnson's back, so that might help the running game a little bit on my bench. So that will be, you know, that'll be interesting. You know, Nick Chubb, you know, I think, you know, if they can get good points out of him, and you know, David Montgomery, if they can just keep it rolling with that, I think that might be the X factor for Gonzo Cats. Is David Montgomery going into the playoffs? So that's what I think from that end of it. So.
Isn't NWA just, I don't know, it's his year. I feel like he made a wrong move against me with the Herbert and Murray thing, but he went with Murray and he was terrible. But then he ends up putting Jonathan Taylor into a starting lineup and he puts in 20.
Yeah,
like I just feel like your destiny.
I feel like he's gonna end up messing up somewhere because he's been kind of playing this game lately of Herbert Murray, and if he comes out on the wrong side of that somewhere, I think it's gonna hurt him. So he's got to make sure of all decisions he makes, he's got to make the right decision at quarterback.
Yeah, agree with you.
Even at wide receiver, I know he's got Diggs, he's got Mike Evans, he's got Claypool. I mean, he could run all those guys into even including his flex. But you know, Cam Akers been playing well. Josh Jacobs, obviously, from what I heard today, he's probably not playing this weekend. I mean, it's nice to have some options, but yeah, you're right. It could be one false move, and that's it for you.
Well, and the odd thing is I don't know. I noticed it. I looked at the snap percentages for whatever reason this week, and maybe this is just a one-time week thing. Claypool snaps were severely reduced yesterday in favor of James Washington. So I don't know what's going on with that, but something to keep an eye on if you're him.
Yeah, no kidding.
Because there's only one.
Mikey's helping out G right now. That's what G better listen to the podcast this week. He may not know that, or maybe he will. He's been good all year, so I really can't say too much about it.
Because yeah, there's only one football with all those weapons in Pittsburgh. Yeah, you gotta, you know, you gotta hope maybe it was, you know, just an off week or something, and you know, or did something, he said something or did something he wasn't supposed to do, so maybe he was, you know, maybe, who knows. But yeah, got to just watch the snaps a little bit there.
You know, I was hoping, like, Russell Wilson's kind of been on a tough streak of late, 31 points, 46, 38, 43, but has a chance to get right against the Jets, as we saw Derek Carr just light him up.
everybody has lit up the Jets.
Yeah. Yeah, you bet.
Look at these point total here: 65 from Carr, 47 Fitzpatrick, 70 from Herbert, 50 from Cam Newton, which is incredible, through 274 yards. And I don't think Cam Newton's had a game over 100 yards passing since then. 77 from Patrick Mahomes. Yep.
You better hope.
Now, the only thing that he's got to worry about is running back situation, because that is struggling.
Yeah. But, like I said, you better hope Russell Wilson doesn't, you know, drop like 90. But yeah, it's going to be
definitely.
Well, it's going to be it. So But yeah, you know, like I said, it's been a very, you know, said it's been a very interesting season, obviously, with what's been going on in the world and everything like that. But you know, hey, it's you gotta adapt just like with anything, you know, in the world. So you know, fantasy football is no different. And you know, the breaks go, you know, sometimes the breaks go your way and go your way, sometimes they don't. You know, just hopefully for next year that we can, you know, maybe back to normalcy, like I said, whatever that'll be. And, you know, they won't have to worry about, oh, is, you know, this player, you know, have COVID and can't play, or, you know, because injuries we're already used to anyway. You know, I mean, obviously this season, the fact that, you know, week two was kind of, I don't know what you'd call that, but that was like a, you know, injuries, like just a dark day for the NFL for how many injuries there was that week. So, you know, got to just be prepared for that one. But hopefully in 2021.
Well, Todd, this is not the end of the season show.
Well, I know, but
it'll be a lot.
Well, it's the end of my season.
At the end of the season stuff on the end of the season show.
Yeah, well, it's the end of my season, okay? All right? End of my season.
That's true.
Yeah,
Todd, so, Mike, you said you had to score how many points more than me to have a chance?
103? No. I'd score like 170, I think, right?
150.
Yeah, 170.
How many points did you score?
150.
So add those up. How many points did you need?
That's
300, Todd. Jesus Christ.
Sorry.
You gotta take that math class for the fourth time.
All right.
Hey, Todd, guess what?
What?
You're done.
Okay.
Hey, I got 12 points out of Marquise Brown. That's probably
wow. Congratulations.
That's probably his best performance all season long.
Did he have a touchdown last week?
No. Did he?
I thought he had that long touchdown pass because it was at the end of the game from Tracy. Oh. What was that dude's name? Trace McSorley.
Oh, yeah.
This is why you're done. All right. Gentlemen, thanks for coming on the podcast. And playoff time, I guess I'll wish everybody luck. However, if things don't go my way, I might be sleeping on your couch, Mikey. I'm just telling you now. I can't. Like, if I have to – wow, part of me is like, wouldn't it be great if I ended his streak? At the same time, I still have to live with him if I lose. Such the breaks. So, for Mikey Renault, do you want to say something, Miguel?
I was just going to say, the biggest key for you guys' matchup is Aaron really needs Mark Andrews back from the COVID.
I read that today.
Because Cleveland is the worst team against tight ends, so to be able to get him back, I mean, it'd be big, but...
Yeah, I thought I read today that he was probably not going to make it. So I should go pick up all the backups so he can't have them.
Cool, Nick Cole. There you go.
Yeah. All right. Well, there you go. Mikey trying to give Aaron some advice. I don't appreciate that. For Mikey Bruneau, Todd Diamond, I'm Eric Lansing. We'll see you next week on the MHA podcast.